Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Seven Games, A Human History, by Oliver Roeder. Read by William Sarris. God is dead, and we have killed him. What festivals of atonement, what sacred games shall we have to invent? Is not the greatness of this deed too great for us? Friedrich Nietzsche, The Parable of the Madman. I'm a machine, and you're a machine, and we both think, don't we? Claude Shannon, when asked whether machines could think. Seven Games. Prologue. Making music, were you? They cried. Very well, now dance. Aesop. Aesop told a fable about two neighbors, an ant and a grasshopper. One warm summer day, the grasshopper emerges from his home and stretches his hind wings. Basking happily in the sun, he decides to spend the day at play. The grasshopper sets off merrily through the field and comes across the ant, who is scurrying back and forth, muttering to himself. The ant is hard at work stockpiling seeds for the winter. "Hey, ant," the grasshopper says, "come and play with me." "No," the ant mutters in solemn reply, "there is work to be done. Winter is coming and I need food." The grasshopper laughs. "But you have plenty of food right now. Come on, let's play." The ant refuses again and returns to his toil. The grasshopper continues on his way, alone but happy, inventing and perfecting his games in the meadow. Days pass, and then weeks and months, and eventually winter does come. The meadow freezes over and food becomes scarce. The grasshopper, seedless, goes hungry. The ant eats well from his stockpile. The end. In this fable, the grasshopper is supposed to be a cautionary figure. The ant is the diligent hero. The diligent hero of this book, however, is the grasshopper, the player of games. Introduction. The view we take in the following pages is that culture arises in the form of play, that it is played from the very beginning. It is through this playing that society expresses its interpretation of life and the world. Johann Huizinga, Homo Ludens. There is an island in the mangrove swamp in southern Mexico made almost entirely out of clamshells. 5,000 years ago, before the rise of the great Mesoamerican civilizations of the Olmec, Aztec, and Maya, a group of people fished and gathered shellfish on this island. As the generations passed, countless clams were cooked and eaten. Their shells were discarded and crushed into the ground. Perhaps growing weary of walking on broken shells, the people began to build clay floors. They installed racks to dry their fish. More shells were crushed, and the island continued to grow. Eventually, the people built something else, too. Something that would puzzle the archaeologists who would discover the site millennia later. It was a simple thing, a curved pattern of small holes embedded in the clay floor above the shells. Archaeologists tend to classify ancient discoveries into either the utilitarian, the clay floor, the drying racks, or the ritualistic, a temple, say. But the pattern on the floor stumped them, seeming, as it did, to belong to neither category. It was an ancient mystery, neither practical nor devout. Or, maybe more profoundly, it was both. It was a game, one of the earliest known. For the fisherfolk of Tlacuachero, game-playing had apparently become one of the necessities of life, writes the anthropologist Barbara Voorhees, who has studied the site extensively. Ancient Mesoamericans weren't alone in their fondness for play. Archaeologists have pondered ancient findings from countless places. In a gravesite in Egypt, for example, dating from the Neolithic period before the pharaohs, diggers found a game called senet, with pieces molded of dried mud. They've found games from ancient Persia, too, and ancient India and ancient China, wherever humans settled, games became necessities of life. In each of these far-flung societies, games straddled the utilitarian and the ritualistic. Egyptian senet was played by both peasants and kings. In secular terms, it required strategic planning and a sophisticated understanding of probability, as players tossed casting sticks, essentially ancient dice, to race a set of pawns around a board. But senet also represented the connection between life and death, and the movement of ba, a concept similar to the Western idea of a soul. The senet board effectively became the netherworld, writes the archaeologist Peter Piccione. The royal game of Ur was first played in ancient Mesopotamia. It is also a strategy game played with dice. It had at least one earthly attraction, gambling, and a heavenly one as well. The spaces a player's pieces landed on were thought to symbolize messages from the beyond, declarations of her fate. A recent archaeological study painstakingly traces the game's spread across the Middle East. It has been found at hundreds of sites in many countries from across hundreds of years, essentially unchanged. You know a version of this game today. It's called backgammon. Another ancient game from Egypt, with versions later mentioned by Plato and Homer, became modern checkers. An ancient game from India, used for military training, became modern chess. One from China, used for similar purposes, became Go. Playing cards, and therefore games such as poker and bridge, can be traced back 1,000 years to the development of printing. Games remain necessities of life today. For one thing, they're fun. They activate and satisfy psychological desires. Pleasure derives from immersing oneself in games' worlds, or in improving one's skills, or in benefiting from their systems of chance. The real world may from time to time offer us a chance to solve an elegant problem, and the satisfaction that comes with it, but games offer this chance constantly. While other art forms like painting or film might capture some visual aspect of the world, a game records a set of decisions and actions, packing them onto a small board, into a deck of cards, or onto a hard drive. In other words, games offer a space to enjoy agency. When playing games, we can take up goals temporarily, not because we actually care about achieving them in an enduring way, but because we want to have a certain kind of struggle, writes C.T. Nguyen, a philosopher at the University of Utah. And we can do so for the sake of aesthetic experiences of striving, of our own gracefulness, of the delicious perfection of an intellectual epiphany, of the intensity of the struggle, or of the dramatic arc of the whole thing. Games also offer simplified models of a dauntingly complicated world, with dynamics that we can grasp and master. Playing a game, entering what the cultural historian Johann Huizinga called the magic circle, or the space created when players sit down to play, is adopting a unique way of seeing and acting in the world. We can take parts of ourselves into this magic circle, and we can take parts of the game back out with us. The border between the two is thin and often porous. Learning a game's intricacies and playing that game with others binds us with other humans, shaping our culture and indeed our perspective on the real world. Any game can at any time wholly run away with the players, Huizinga writes. The contrast between play and seriousness is always fluid. The inferiority of play is continually being offset by the corresponding superiority of its seriousness. Play turns to seriousness and seriousness to play. Play may rise to heights of beauty and sublimity that leave seriousness far beneath. This book explores 7 games in depth. Checkers, whose reputation as a child's game belies its haunting depth. Chess, the canonical and ubiquitous game of military strategy in the West. Go, the elegant and intricate surrounding game of the East. Backgammon, the best and cruelest game played with dice. Poker, the world's most popular card game in our capitalistic age. Scrabble, the canonical word game. And Bridge, the pinnacle of strategic card games. Each of these games has developed its own unique personality. Competitive play has produced a voluminous tactical literature, studied and revered by a unique subculture of masters. The games themselves are fascinating characters, each with its own virtues and its own flaws. I, too, love these games. In graduate school, I studied game theory, wanting to spend as much time as I could thinking about the mathematical underpinnings of these pursuits. And when I got my first journalism job, I wrote a weekly column and countless other articles about games and puzzles, wanting to explore and proselytize about the rich worlds that games contain. To write this book, I competed in the World Series of Poker in Las Vegas and the North American Scrabble Championship in Reno, Nevada. I studied famous chess problems and volumes of theory, and I taught everyone I know to play backgammon, whether they liked it or not. I also met the game's elite practitioners. In an apartment on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, for example, a wealthy bridge player assembled his well-paid team of ringers. In the Las Vegas desert, a group of poker professionals underwent a moral crisis. In a hotel ballroom in New Jersey, the world's best backgammon player lamented the loss of a seedier time. And in Washington Square Park, a grizzled chess hustler tried to wring a few dollars out of me through the game of kings. What is a game? This simple question has vexed great thinkers. The illustrious Cambridge philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, for example, failed to find an answer, deciding that there was no proper definition. All one could do, he said, was recognize certain family resemblances among games. For if you look at them, he wrote, you will not see something that is common to all, but similarities, relationships, and a whole series of them at that. Others were unsatisfied with this analysis. Bernard Suits, a relatively obscure but aptly named scholar who spent most of his career at the University of Waterloo in Canada, was perhaps the first true philosopher of games. He dismissed Wittgenstein for his cowardice and offered instead a definition. It hinges on what he called a lucery attitude, a state of mind required by a person playing a game. Derived from the Latin ludere, meaning to play, a lucery attitude is that of the grasshopper. To play a game, Suits wrote, is to attempt to achieve a specific state of affairs, prelusory goal, using only means permitted by rules, lucery means, where the rules prohibit use of more efficient in favor of less efficient means, constitutive rules, and where the rules are accepted just because they make possible such activity, lucery attitude. Or, put more succinctly, a game is the voluntary attempt to overcome unnecessary obstacles. Suits' work, published mostly in the 1960s and 70s, is the clearest rubric we have for understanding what games truly are and for how to think about them. The philosopher Thomas Herka, who provided the summarizing bracketed phrases in Suits' definition, called it a precisely placed boot in Wittgenstein's balls. The grasshopper is Suits' hero too, and his argument about games, which takes the form of a parody of a Platonic dialogue, reverses the moral of Aesop's fable. Suits imagines a future world he calls Utopia. In Utopia, advanced technology has solved all the problems of scarcity. Humanity is well-fed, well-clothed, and well-housed. Such a future would be blandly pleasant, perhaps, but boring. Without games, that is. The notable institutions of Utopia, accordingly, will not be economic, moral, scientific, and erotic instruments, as they are today, but institutions which foster sport and other games, he writes. Perhaps the grasshopper is a sort of ant after all. We thus call games pastimes, and regard them as trifling fillers of the interstices in our lives, Suits concluded. But they are much more important than that. they are clues to the future, and their serious cultivation now is perhaps our only salvation. Why do we play games? Imagine you're an early human. The world is harsh, and you have to hunt wild animals for food. You have a few options. One, you could hunt all the time. This, however, would put your life in regular peril, and therefore endanger the propagation of your genes. Two, you could hunt only when you were hungry. But then you would be unskilled at hunting and run the risk of starving to death. Three, you could practice. You could invent a game that would motivate you to engage in this practice. For example, first player to throw a rock and hit that tree wins. This game improves your aim, which improves your hunting ability without the risk. According to this theory, adding structure to play, that is, inventing and playing games, is central to our developmental intelligence. I first heard this account not from an anthropologist or archaeologist or evolutionary biologist, but rather from a computer scientist. If games have been central to the development of human intelligence, they have been just as central to the development of artificial intelligence, the sort of technology its creators hope that could one day solve certain persistent problems of human society and bring about utopia. As long as there have been computers, their programmers have harnessed human games. For 2 months in 1956, a cadre of computer scientists, mathematicians, and psychologists assembled for a workshop on a leafy Ivy League campus. The Dartmouth Summer Research Project on Artificial Intelligence is now considered a founding event of that field, and the document proposing the meeting is an urtext of AI. The authors requested $13,500 in funding and made their ambitions clear. We think of machines performing the most advanced human thought activities, providing theorems, writing music, or playing chess. Games attract AI researchers for the same reason they attract human players. They are fun, but they are also practice. Games are potent distillations of narrow elements of the real world, and by mastering these elements, computers master aspects of the human world. Indeed, games have become the most visible success story of artificial intelligence, with a dramatic series of human versus machine contests instilling in our species both humility of place and pride of invention. For some of these researchers, the games were a means to an end, mere test beds for new approaches in computer science that they hoped would cross the porous border and be used later in more serious endeavors. For others, the games were the thing, and they hoped that their computer systems would reveal new truths, new strategies and tactics, new ways of thinking. Out of both of these camps of scientists came new creations, literally superhuman artificial intelligences, albeit limited in scope to the narrow band of their particular game. At the same time, these superhuman intelligences were also tools to play the game better. Inventing tools to augment skill is one of Homo sapiens' foundational behaviors. Therefore, human versus machine contests are also human versus human contests. I, too, enjoy getting better at games, learning new truths about them. So I recently spent a long time playing games against these creations. I played chess and Go and backgammon and poker and Scrabble against opponents who couldn't talk, but nonetheless destroyed me. I knew the programs were written in bloodless code, but I found that they had their own personalities. And I discovered the stories of their programmers. In the wilderness of Oregon, an astrophysicist and programmer pondered the mathematics of bridge. In an IBM office in rural New York, a small team built a supercomputer that became perhaps the world's best chess player. On the icy campus of the University of Alberta, a professor upended his family in pursuit of a solution to checkers. And in a Google office in London, an elite squadron conquered the most beautiful and most complex board game on the planet. The seven games in this book belong to a rough hierarchy, Each game on the list adds a strategic feature, and therefore more closely hews to some aspect of the real world. The aspects of each game crystallize a specific and potent form of agency, and when taken together, these aspects form a rough menu of intelligence. Computer scientists and their algorithms have been making their way through the list, on their way perhaps to truly general artificial intelligence. Checkers allows you to practice basic strategy, but its canvas is limited and its moves often rote. Add different pieces with more complex movements, and you produce chess, a game that for centuries has been associated with intelligence itself. Or increase the number of pieces and the size of the board, like managing not just a small tribe but a giant civilization, and you have Go, the mathematically richest game played by humans. But life is random and is always throwing you some unexpected new development. Practice for that with backgammon, which relies on chance. Poker models a world of hidden knowledge and deceit. Scrabble demands that a player make intertemporal trade-offs between satisfying desires today and saving up for tomorrow. Bridge, perhaps the most human of all the games in this book, offers a world of flourishing language, alliances, communication, empathy, and cheating. Games have had a special cultural longevity. They appear among the ancient relics of humankind and in the code of cutting-edge software. The same ones that were played in ancient cities of bygone empires are played by supercomputers. They are a backbone both of our own species and of the ongoing creation of a new kind of being. Maybe Bernard Suits was right. Their serious cultivation is perhaps our salvation. Life itself contains both necessary and unnecessary obstacles, and both voluntary and involuntary attempts to overcome them. Perhaps then what matters is one's attitude toward overcoming these obstacles. Perhaps a ludic attitude is a valuable resource. Perhaps life is a game. Perhaps we're grasshoppers, after all. Checkers. The bird fights its way out of the egg. The egg is the world. Who would be born must first destroy a world. The bird flies to God. Hermann Hesse, Demian. One quiet afternoon in 1990, a book collector named Jonathan Schaefer stood in his office in Edmonton, Canada. He grasped a sharp pocket knife in one hand and a treasured volume in the other. Schaefer, a sturdy man with open features and thick mop of curly dark hair, was contemplating dismemberment. With a wince, he made two surgical incisions in the binding, ridding the book of its cover. This freed the 200 pages inside, which Schaefer held carefully in his hands. He was overcome, he recalled, with morbid fascination. Schaefer, then 33 years old, specialized in rare, leather-bound volumes about Arctic and Antarctic explorers and disasters. He sensed magic in these books. Holding history in his hands, he would read the accounts of the vain but heroic attempts to rescue the lost souls, of the bravado of a long time ago. In a large glass case in his living room floats a model of the HMS Erebus, a 19th-century naval ship that was icebound and abandoned in the Northwest Passage. Tiny plastic sailors stand on bergs around their motionless vessel, hundreds of miles from civilization. Schaefer wanted desperately to be a part of history. The mutilated volume Schaefer held contained travelogues of a different kind. They described journeys into the cold mathematical depths of the game of checkers. The book detailed the moves made in 732 games played by Marion Tinsley, the greatest human checkers player who ever lived. Schaefer was going to dissect them one by one. Tinsley was the Ernest Shackleton of the game, a legendary bespectacled figure in a professor's suit and tie. Over a 40-year stretch of competitive play, comprising more than 1,000 serious tournament checkers games, he lost exactly 3 times. He won the U.S. National Championship 9 times and the World Championship 7 times, or maybe 8, but more on that later. He'd have won many more titles if he had not disappeared from the game's tournament scene for so long. Schaefer, on the other hand, by his own admission, was a checkers novice, aware of little beyond the rudiments of the game. But in addition to being an avid book collector, Schaefer was, and is, a professor of computer science at the University of Alberta, working in artificial intelligence. For the past year, his academic work had involved building a computer program to play expert checkers. He intended to pore over Tinsley's moves in search of some hidden checker's secrets, some weakness in Tinsley's game. The research project had taken on the cast of a personal crusade, and the monomaniacal obsession with defeating the great man over the checkerboard would eventually dominate Schaefer's career and personal life. In his office, Schaefer fed the flattened pages from the dismembered book through his university's state-of-the-art optical character recognition machine. The system scanned the printed text, digitizing the games of the great human master. Schaefer then uploaded the digital records of the games into his artificially intelligent checkers system. In some parts of the world, checkers is known as drafts. Schaefer called his system Chinook, after a warm wind that blows through Canada like California's Santa Ana. Chinook analyzed Tinsley's games, hundreds of them. The program ran on 4 machines simultaneously for 2 weeks straight. At last, Chinook finished, and Schaefer examined the results. To his creeping horror, he discovered that Tinsley hadn't made a single mistake. Humans have been playing some version of checkers for millennia. Early in Plato's Republic, written around 380 BC, Socrates goes to the philosopher Polemarchus's house to discuss justice. The conversation turns to checkers, pesos. The classicist and translator Alan Bloom explains, in Plato, checkers is often employed as a symbol of dialectic, just as house building or architecture frequently stands for lawgiving. In dialectic, premises, like pieces, are set down and are changed in relation to the moves of one's partners. The game can be played over, and one's moves can be improved on the basis of experience with the opponent's moves. It is a friendly combat and an amusement for its own sake. Distant family relations of the game have been dated to the 2nd millennium BC and unearthed in Crete, Cyprus, Egypt, Iran, Iraq, Israel, Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, and Turkey. A game called Alkerke, a parent of modern checkers, is mentioned in the Book of Songs, a 20-volume 10th-century work by an Arabic historian. Alkerke contained the basic movements and piece-taking of modern checkers. The variant described in the Book of Games, a 13th-century document commissioned by a Spanish king, introduced the concept of crowning, kingmi, in which those special pieces can move either forward or backward. In the 17th century, the rule that you have to jump an opponent's piece whenever possible was incorporated. Since then, modern checkers has flourished so successfully that no fuller explanation here of its rules is really necessary. They seem woven into human DNA. Checkers move diagonally, hopping over enemies to capture them, and becoming kings should they arrive at the far end of the board. Playing chess is like looking out over a limitless ocean, Tinsley once said. Playing checkers is like looking into a bottomless well. Marion Franklin Tinsley was born on February 3, 1927, in Ironton, Ohio, an industrial town across the river from the Kentucky county where his father was sheriff. His mother was a schoolteacher, and he had 2 brothers and a twin sister, Mary. When Tinsley was a young boy, the family moved to a farm, which they would lose shortly thereafter in the aftermath of the Great Depression. The exact moment Tinsley discovered checkers is lost in this history. He learned it at home or at school. He claimed not to remember which. but it seems to have always been a part of him. His family eventually wound up in Columbus, Ohio, and welcomed into their home a boarder named Mrs. Kershaw. Tinsley regularly played checkers with his dad and his brother and Mrs. Kershaw. She'd beat him and rub it in and laugh, Tinsley later recalled. Oh, how she'd cackle as she'd jump my men. Tinsley was a precocious student. He excelled at math and memorized poems and skipped 4 of the first 8 grades. He attributed his acceleration to his mother's fear that, as a result of hard farm life, she might not live to raise her children. Education was seen as a path out of poverty. By age 15, he was enrolled at Ohio State University. In the library, a beginner's text called Winning Checkers caught his eye. Having acquired a dislike for losing and a love of books, this discovery set the stage for a lifelong fascination, he'd recall. For the rest of his college years, he devoted 8 hours a day to the game. He had visions of beating Mrs. Kershaw, her cackle rattling in his brain. He wouldn't get the chance. She'd since left the family home. But the visions drove his obsession, as did a nagging sense that he was the less favored twin, and that his parents smiled instead on Mary. Tinsley entered his first checkers tournament, a minor event in Louisiana, in 1945. He won. He took the Ohio State Juniors that same year, and was runner-up in the national championship the year after that, at age 19. A string of a dozen tournament and match victories came in the next 5 years, including his first national championship. A dozen more came in the 5 years after that, including his first world championship. Tinsley is said to have spent 20,000 hours during the late 1940s and early 50s studying checkers. That was nothing. A hero of his, the former world champion Asa Long, is reported to have devoted 100,000 hours to studying the game. That fact should answer a few questions about this simple game, Tinsley wrote. In 1958, at age 31, he won his 3rd world championship in blindingly dominant fashion, 9-1 with 24 draws against the 2nd best player in the world. This feat cemented him as an untouchable great. At the peak of his powers, however, Tinsley disappeared from the game. He'd recently completed a PhD and begun teaching abstract algebra and combinatorial analysis, a branch of math concerned with counting complex combinations of objects. He'd also, through the competitive checkers world, found religion. This newfound calling would quickly occupy Tinsley's time and mind, much as checkers had. Tinsley's mother was religious, baptized the way Jesus was in the waters of a stream. But in college, Tinsley was a practicing and professing unbeliever. A checkers friend obstinately confronted this unfaith. He would present Tinsley with biblical prophecies, asking him, "Now, how do you explain that?" Another checkers figure, Charles Walker, was the secretary of the American Checker Federation and the founder of the International Checker Hall of Fame in Petal, Mississippi. "You couldn't spend more than a few minutes around him," Tinsley recalled, "without him asking if you were saved." The two became close, Tinsley and Walker regularly testifying their faith to other players and praying for the sick among them. Walker later became Tinsley's promoter. Tinsley recalled that upon his first visit to the Hall of Fame, they prayed for a comatose woman whose family was awaiting her imminent death. Shortly thereafter, he said, she awoke, asked for food, and lived for another 5 years. Tinsley wrote that the best part about winning tournaments and matches was in sharing these accomplishments with my mother. His faith became another thing he could share with her. Along with their church, the two gave sacrificially to help build a hospital in Zimbabwe. "All I am or hope to be, I owe to my darling mother," Tinsley wrote. Tinsley became a volunteer part-time minister at the Church of Christ. He produced a biblical radio program. He taught the Book of Revelation in a weekly class. He joined the Charismatic movement, which embraced the practices of Pentecostalism. He performed intricate analyses of the Bible, and, the Orlando Sentinel reported, worked for years making an outline of the Old Testament from the New Testament perspective. He preached at a predominantly black church. Tinsley is white. He was once diagnosed with a rare blood disorder and given, he said, not long to live. He had surgery to remove his gallbladder and spleen. He fully recovered, and later told friends that his religious healing sessions helped save his life. During his absence from Checkers, Tinsley also moved from teaching at Florida State to teaching at Florida A&M, a historically black university. "I had thought of going to Africa as a self-supporting missionary," Tinsley told Sports Illustrated, "until a sharp-tongued sister pointed out to me that most people who wanted to help blacks in Africa wouldn't even talk to blacks in America." In 1970, after a 12-year absence from competitive checkers, Tinsley returned. He was 43. This return was another charitable act. Tinsley had been quietly playing casual games on the side and had become good friends with Don Lafferty, another one of the best players in the world. Tinsley was concerned about Lafferty's health, deteriorated as it was from a life of hard drinking. Lafferty offered Tinsley a deal. Lafferty would quit drinking if Tinsley returned to the game. Tinsley accepted. His own father had also battled alcoholism. Tinsley, at least, upheld his end of the bargain. Having returned, he dominated checkers, as perhaps no one has dominated any competitive pursuit in the history of humankind. He won the next 28 tournaments and championship matches he entered, none being particularly close. He defeated Lafferty himself in a world championship. At one point, he went a full decade without losing a single game. During his historic return to championship play, Tinsley lived with his mother in a house south of Tallahassee. Shelves in an upstairs den held some 200 checkers books. The Modern Encyclopedia of Checkers, his other Bible, its margins filled with his notations and corrections, had to be rebound after heavy use. Note-taking appears to be compulsive among serious checkers players. The used copy I bought, a small volume bound in blue leather with gold embossing, is filled with dense marginalia and has typewritten game records taped inside. The room was also littered with tall championship trophies, and a bespoke checkerboard sat at the ready on a cluttered table. Tinsley never married and had no children. "It is a very rare woman who can be married to a real student of checkers," he once said. At his bedside was a smaller magnetic board for spontaneous checkers analysis. When studying checkers, he favored a soundtrack of Bach, Brahms, and Handel. Outside of checkers, he preferred spirituals. But the books and boards in his house were little more than props. The real checkers work happened in Tinsley's mind. He could play 20 games at once, blindfolded, and win them all. He put himself through college playing such exhibitions for $50 apiece, according to a profile in Sports Illustrated. Checkers' ideas and improvements on the moves documented in his collected books would come to him out of the clear blue sky. His insights into scripture, he said, came the same way. At tournaments, Tinsley favored a green suit with a red tie and horn-rimmed glasses. A tuft of white hair peeked over an otherwise bald head. In early photographs, he looks like a young Edward R. Murrow, with the checkerboard as an anchor desk. Later in life, the frail professor appeared to blend into the game itself, his jacket matching the board's green squares and his tie matching the red checkers. The phenom Bobby Fischer famously haggled over the $125,000 purse for his chess world championship. Tinsley, far and away more dominant than Fischer, but anonymous to the American public, was playing for prize money that never exceeded $5,000. "Checkers players tend to be a little humble," Tinsley said on the eve of yet another world title defense, held as many of them had been at Charles Walker's lavish Hall of Fame, a building completely out of proportion with the fame of its honorees, where Tinsley always stayed in the crown room, reserved for Checkers champions of the world. They realize the world does not think that much of them. Between Tinsley's two legendary runs in 1963, a blind checkers expert named Robert Neely took a seat alone in front of a checkerboard in his home in Stamford, Connecticut. He'd been playing checkers seriously for decades, held the state's championship title, and was at that moment engrossed in one of a series of six games, intently studying its positions by feeling for the pieces with his hands. When he finally decided on his move, he typed it on a postcard and mailed it to an address 25 miles away at the IBM Watson Research Center in Yorktown Heights, New York. And then he waited. Once the postcard arrived at the center in New York, Neely's move was keyed by technicians into a punch card and fed into an IBM 7094 mainframe computer, which then searched tens of thousands of checkers' positions, as deep as 20 moves into the future, and selected its response. The computer's move was then duly recorded on a postcard and sent back to Connecticut, where Neely played it on his board. Though he was not an especially notable player in the pantheon of master checkers players, Neely triumphed for humanity, postcard by postcard over 5 months, scoring one win and five draws. Nevertheless, the program itself was an achievement and a watershed. It was perhaps the first computer program that ever learned. In its August 1964 issue, Popular Mechanics ran a photo of an IBM engineer named Arthur Samuel examining a 150-foot-long roll of paper printed out by the IBM 7094. It was a list of instructions for Samuel's checkers playing program. Samuel was born in small-town Kansas, and talked his way, literally, into MIT and a job at General Electric. After earning his PhD, he found a position at Bell Telephone Laboratories, where he worked on various machines, including a multi-cavity magnetron and a microwave klystron. He published many papers, for example, a method of obtaining a linear time axis for a cathode ray oscillograph, and was granted 57 patents. But Samuel, seeking a better salary, decamped for the University of Illinois in 1946. With tenure, he indulged in some of his more theoretical interests, particularly having to do with electrical charge. This research required the intricate numerical operations of calculus, which in private industry, according to a history of Samuel's work in the IEEE Annals of the History of Computing, would have been done by a staff of women computers using electromechanical desk calculators. Samuel did not have this human resource at the university, nor was he about to do these calculations by hand. The thing to do was to buy or build a computer, Samuel wrote. He decided to build. His dean at Illinois arranged $110,000 for the project, and Samuel began barnstorming the country's finest institutions of higher learning, hosting lectures, and employing graduate students to hone his plans. But by 1948, the project had stalled. Running out of money, he decided to stage a publicity stunt, build a bare-bones version of the computer, and have it do something impressive. Samuel had heard that Claude Shannon, a mathematician back at Bell Labs, was talking about making computers play chess. It ought to be dead easy to program a computer to play checkers, Samuel reasoned. So he began to write a checkers program for an enormous machine that did not exist. Not long after, Samuel took a job at the International Business Machines Corporation. He began at IBM in 1949, when the company was in the midst of developing a large commercial digital computer, its first, which would come to be called the IBM 701. The company told its shareholders that this defense calculator would be the most advanced, most flexible high-speed computer in the world. One of the first things it did was run Samuel's checkers program. The 701s rented for $11,900 a month, more than $100,000 today, and were capable of more than 2,000 multiplications per second. Each night, from midnight to 8 a.m. on the factory floor, Samuel would load one version of his checkers program into one of the huge machines, and a second version onto another, and have them play each other over and over again. Each version was programmed to learn differently, and Samuel could observe their results. He learned how machines learned. I became one of the very first to work in the general field later to become known as artificial intelligence, Samuel wrote in an unfinished and unpublished autobiography. In fact, I became so intrigued with this general problem of writing a program that would appear to exhibit intelligence that it was to occupy my thoughts during almost every free moment for the entire duration of my employment by IBM, and indeed for some years beyond. He wasn't alone in his self-assessment. One computer historian wrote that Samuel's checkers player was clearly the world's first self-learning computer program and the first functioning artificial intelligence program. IBM didn't mind Samuel's late-night gaming in its factory. At least someone was testing its expensive machines. But it did not publicize his research. Then, as now, there was fear of AI. IBM salesmen did not mention the company's artificial intelligence research to their customers, nor did they speculate about the company's future innovations. When Samuel finally did write about his work for public consumption in 1959, he offered the following conclusion. A computer can be programmed so that it will learn to play a better game of checkers than can be played by the person who wrote the program. Samuel could have gone further. A computer can be programmed to play checkers like God. So, how does a computer play a game? Imagine standing at the base of a very tall tree, looking up. The tree is all the possible futures of a game. The trunk represents your next move, a big limb some possible move after that, the smaller branches some moves later, and the countless tiny twigs and leaves way at the top a continuation of possible moves in the distant futures of the game, the end games. Humans stare up at the tree and are reminded of trees we've climbed, trees we've seen, and trees our friends have told us about before. We have an innate primal sense about which limbs can bear our weight and which branches will bend under pressure, and we know which twigs seem hardy. We remember the times we fell and how we made it to the top. We write down which branches are safe and which are risky, and we share this knowledge with our fellow humans. We climb trees, that is, we play games, through our intuition, experience, community, and literature. Computers, on the other hand, have no such intuition for the tree, but they can climb all over the place very fast, like a colony of ants. This is called search. At each point on the tree that they happen to arrive, they perform a small calculation, assessing that location's quality and awarding it a score. This is called evaluation. Before any move in a game like checkers, a computer's ants might climb to millions of places on the tree, collecting calculations. If one route upward returns higher scores, that's where the computer will head. Computers climb trees, that is, they play games, by searching and evaluating, searching and evaluating, searching and evaluating. Both search and evaluation present serious technical challenges. For one thing, there are 500 quintillion 995 quadrillion 484 trillion 682 billion 338 million 672,639, or about 500 billion billion possible positions in a game of checkers. Schaefer offers this analogy. If the Pacific Ocean were empty, and you had to fill it with a small cup, the number of cupfuls you'd need is equal to the number of possible positions in the game of checkers. Try another. If the entire land surface area of the Earth represented all the possible checkers positions, an individual position would be equal to a thousandth of a square inch. Searching efficiently, therefore, is critical. If, by brute force, we looked at each of these positions for a thousandth of a second each, doing something similar to what Samuel's machine did, looking at all of them would take longer than the age of the universe. Evaluating any given game position, once we do look at it, is not trivial. In checkers, certain features of a position are desirable. Having more checkers, having more kings, having control of the center of the board, and so on. And certain features are undesirable. Having your checkers relegated to the sides of the board, having an unprotected back rank, and so on. The trick is to turn that tapestry of features and the complicated non-linear mathematical interactions among them into a single number that your computer program can understand. Marion Tinsley relied on human intuition and calculation, and his ability to digest and retain the checker's wisdom of the humans who came before him. He could look up nearly any tree and find the best path to the top, operating on the low wattage of the human brain. But as he began his second run, in 1970, the ants were multiplying and gaining speed. Now, one might be tempted to ask a computer scientist why she spends her valuable time and energy and her grant money creating computer programs to play board games. The computer scientist will invariably reply with one of the following stock answers. Games are test beds. Games provide benchmarks for the performance of artificial intelligence systems. Games allow computer performance to be easily compared to human performance. Games are simplified models of aspects of the real world. Or, if she is being slightly more forthcoming, games are fun. And those answers are fine, but none of them are really true. The true motivation of a computer scientist developing a game-playing AI is not dissimilar to that of a parent spending valuable time and energy raising a child. It is an act of creation. Mary Shelley's Dr. Frankenstein, upon contemplating his creature, said, "A new species would bless me as its creator and source. Many happy and excellent natures would owe their being to me. No father could claim the gratitude of his child so completely as I should deserve theirs." Jonathan Schaefer felt this the first time one of his algorithmic creations beat him at a game. "I could create intelligent behavior," he wrote. "I was scared." Schaefer, born in Toronto in 1957, grew up playing games. In One Jump Ahead, Schaefer's book describing his checkers odyssey, a bildungsroman for his computer program, he floridly describes his early fascination with chess, what with its Arthurian pieces defending the honor of the king, and their precisely scripted ballet. He likened his love of the game to that of a connoisseur of fine art or music. When he was 16, he earned the game's master title. At the University of Toronto, he meandered from mathematics to physics to computer science, eventually lured to this last field by the promise that while he'd never be a world chess champion, perhaps he could write a program that would be. He learned to code by dissecting a strong existing computer player, written in an early programming language called Fortran. At the University of Waterloo, he spent so much time programming computers to play the game that his dissertation wound up in shambles. No matter, he turned the chess work into a dissertation instead, gave it the academia-approved title Experiments in Search and Knowledge, and graduated in 1986. 2 years later, by then an assistant professor at the University of Alberta, he decided to take a detour into checkers. This was going to be easy, Schaefer thought, as Samuel before him had. After all, it's only checkers. Schaefer had no love for the game, or any fascination with its deep strategic gems, which so captivated Tinsley. His interest was born of baser instincts. "I could give you a lot of valid scientific reasons, but deep in my heart, I knew the true answer," he wrote. "I could win." Checkers came to dominate Schaefer's life. Work on what was initially called The Beast began on June 2, 1989. Schaefer quickly staffed up, enlisting two colleagues who had accidentally steered him toward the game over lunch. He dusted off Samuel's papers, which were by then 3 decades old, and he posted a message, a cry for help, really, on a Usenet group devoted to chess. There wasn't one for checkers. Wanted, his statement read, checkers evaluation function or guidance on how to build one. The only answer came from the Dominion Radio Astrophysical Observatory in British Columbia, sent by a man named Norman Treloar, who was, at the moment, unemployed. Schaefer invited him to Edmonton. Treloar, a short, proper Englishman dressed in a conservative suit, had read Samuel's work closely. It was deeply flawed, he argued, and he knew how to fix it. For one thing, Treloar, unlike Schaefer and Samuel, was an expert checkers player. The Beast became known as Chinook.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.